I'm Jane Fraser. My talk is called My Birth Journey from Tragedy to Triumph. Back in, I think it was 1997, after seeing photos of a friend's home water birth, I decided that was what I wanted when I gave birth. Everything about it just seemed really right to me. So I was all set to replicate that birth scenario with my first pregnancy. But sadly, things didn't go according to plan. And at 25 weeks pregnant, while traveling on the train from Joburg to Cape Town, I went into premature labor. At the time, we thought I had a stomach bug. So while my instinct told me that something was wrong, I was young and naive and didn't really want to trouble anybody. So I was just trying to cope and hang on until we got back to Cape Town. Eventually, after about 12 hours, it was obvious I was not okay, and I was ambulanced off the train in Dar in the Karoo and taken to the local hospital. After being examined, I was told I was already 7 centimeters dilated and having what was termed a spontaneous abortion, and that there was nothing they could do. When I was given the option to transfer to Kimberley, which has neonatal facilities, I jumped at it. So I was given Ibridol to stop the contractions and was bundled into an ambulance, and off we went tearing across the Karoo for over 3 hours in the pouring rain. We finally arrived in Kimberley and were greeted with extreme reluctance. The nurses wouldn't admit me to the maternity ward and told us to go to the ER. They were obviously not in the mood for dealing with another case so close to the end of their shift. When we explained that we were there because we needed the neonatal facilities, they rolled their eyes and told us that 25 weeks is too young. And they also said I couldn't be in their ward because they had other ladies in labor and I'd upset them if I was there. The whole attitude was that we were an unwanted nuisance and irritation to them. I was feeling sick and asked for a bucket and no one responded. When I vomited all over myself on the floor, the nurses sighed and rolled their eyes at me. I kept feeling I had to apologize for disturbing them. Finally, a doctor was called, and I thought that being a trained professional, he would know what to do, and that he would take charge and help us. I was wrong. This doctor also said, 25 weeks is too young. His words were, we'll have to take it out of there. I was shocked and horrified. I asked him if he meant he wanted to do a cesarean, and he said, no, I could deliver it myself if I wanted to. All this time, the baby had been fine, with a strong, healthy heartbeat, membranes were still intact, and the contractions had been stopped. After that, things happened very quickly. I wasn't consulted about anything, and I kept having to ask what they were doing. The nurses were very abrupt, as if who was I to question them. The doctor then ruptured my membranes, and I remember feeling really sad, feeling the warm fluid leaking out and knowing that was a point of no return. I was taken off the Ibridol, and the doctor then proceeded to administer Pitocin. What? He was inducing me. At the time, this seemed really strange and wrong, but I thought he knew what he was doing, so I didn't question him. He then walked out, and I never saw him again. When the nurses came back, they were very rough, and when I told them I didn't want a catheter, I was told I had no choice, I had to have one. There wasn't any time. The Pitocin kicked in and caused a massive contraction which felt as if it was going to rip my legs off. I didn't know what to do with myself and started panicking. The nurse simply told me to push. After just 3 pushes, I gave birth to my baby, a small, perfect little doll of a baby. The nurse cut the cord, said it's a girl, grabbed her and walked away. I had no idea where they were going or if I'd ever get to see her. A few minutes later, the nurse came back, handed the small bundle to me and said, 865 grams, too small, and walked away. A perfect little angel, delicate pink and very much alive. I felt desperate and anxious that nothing was being done to help her, but I knew it was already too late. There's a lot more to the story and the rest is just as bad. At the time, I didn't know any better, but I now know that the primary reason for losing our baby was incorrect medical intervention. I was treated like a problem which needed to be eliminated before the hospital inspection in the morning. It was simply awful, profoundly tragic and traumatic, and it changed me forever. I've shared this story often because this story brought me to who and where I am today, and it reaffirmed my belief that interference in birth can do much more harm than good. And after that experience, I had a conviction that I wanted a birth with no interference. I ended up having 2 successful midwife-assisted natural births in hospital with my boys, Quinn and Griffin, one a water birth and one a land baby. They were very positive and healing experiences for me. I loved their births. In fact, I was so inspired by my gentle, kind, and caring midwife that I actually wanted to become a midwife afterwards. I ended up training and certifying as a doula, and I've watched and helped about 20 babies being born. I've tried to help and empower others to understand their bodies, their rights, their options, and to have positive births without fear. But I always felt like I wanted one last perfect birth experience. I wanted to wait to go into labor naturally and to have that gentle, calm water birth experience that I always envisioned. So when an opportunity arose to carry a baby for Andrew, who wanted a baby of his own, and embarked on the journey of a lifetime, me to have a pregnancy and birth I always dreamed of, and him to get his much longed for baby. The pregnancy went really smoothly, and I stayed active, fit, and healthy throughout. Eventually, at 41 weeks and 2 days, I became aware of contractions a few hours after going to bed. After lying quietly and feeling them coming in a rhythm, I timed them to see if there was a pattern, and I started to suspect that this might be it. I got up quietly and went downstairs and didn't want to wake Andrew too soon, so I left him to sleep and sipped on some honey and lemon tea while posting online that I may be in labor. I was contracting every 3 minutes fairly intensely, and at this point had to stand up and breathe through the contractions. But I was still in denial that I was actually in labor. I thought there'd still be many hours ahead in any event. I then went back upstairs and carried on laboring there, really enjoying being on my own, feeling safe in the calm and quiet. But I was starting to have to really concentrate and breathe. I found the best way for me to labor was standing up, swaying my hips, and leaning forward and bouncing through them. After a while, Andrew heard me low moaning through some of the contractions and woke up. Of course, his first question was, should I call the team? I still wasn't sure and didn't really want anybody intruding on my space yet, but I knew that they were all about an hour or two's drive away, so I said, I think so. I then spoke to my midwife in between contractions, and I think I've sounded far too calm and just fine, so she suspected there was lots of time and decided to have a shower, apparently. Contractions were now coming every 2 to 3 minutes, lasting well over a minute each. I started feeling cold and shivery, and then vomited. In retrospect, hello, transition. Meanwhile, I'm still thinking there's about 8 hours to go. It started feeling pretty intense, with hardly a break in between. I was still coping, but felt I really needed a change, and decided I wanted to be in the water, even if it was maybe too soon. So Andrew prepared the bath for me, and I got in. Water was really great. It really, really works for me, and slowed things down so that I could center myself and catch my breath, and changed the feeling from pain to pressure. After about 20 minutes in the water, contractions started to pick up again and got really strong, and the pressure down there was quite intense. I remember saying, I think I'm going to need to push soon, and next thing I knew, I was pushing. I wasn't sure I should be, though, as I had no idea how dilated I was. So I felt inside, and there, just inside me, was the sac and head. So I reckon if it's all the way down there, I'm pretty sure I'm allowed to push. The head moved down with each push, and within just about two or three, the baby started crowning. And with the next contraction, the ring of fire started. I managed to remember this time that I wanted to hold back and breathe the baby out so that I didn't tear. So I tried not to push and panted and breathe. I remember at this point being more worried about Andrew than anything else, and I said to him, this baby's coming now. And I realized the midwives weren't there yet, but felt actually secretly thrilled by that. And I was really enjoying the quiet solitude and how private, safe, and just right everything felt. I applied some counter pressure with my hands where the burning was the worst, and the head slowly eased out. I remember saying, the head's out, but it's okay, and asked him to take a photo. I felt really calm and one photo. We actually had a birth photographer, but she didn't make it. And I really wanted to make sure he wasn't panicking or worried, seeing it as it was his first baby. I pushed again with the next contractions, and the shoulders weren't coming, and I did have a moment of doubt of, I hope this baby's actually going to come out. And realizing at this point that it was literally in my hands, I decided to give it my all, and with the next contraction gave a hearty push and pulled on his head a little bit, and his shoulders eased out, and then out came his body in his sack. So his head was out, the rest of his body was inside the sack. I peeled it off him and pulled him to the surface of the water and felt his neck, and the cord was wrapped around it, so I just slipped it off the head and patted and rubbed him until he responded. It took a minute or so for him to really wake up and respond, and I think we were both very relieved when he did splutter, open his eyes, and start breathing properly. I stayed in the bath with baby held close and covered with cloth to keep him warm. It was really calm, peaceful, and just felt so right. The birth team arrived about 10 minutes later and took care of all the rest, placenta and the checks and everything else. But what was so important for me was that Andrew held that space so beautifully for me, so I felt safe and undisturbed. He was calm, quiet, and gently supportive, watching but giving me space to do my thing uninterrupted, with no fear, no panic, and no questions. He trusted me to trust myself. It was really amazing and beyond what I'd ever even imagined, and I couldn't actually think of a better birth experience. What an incredible journey and experience, and what a triumph. I'm forever grateful and humbled to have been given this opportunity to complete my circle of birth journeys from tragedy to triumph so magnificently. Thank you.